HarperCollins presents The Close by Jane Casey, read by Caroline Lennon and Nathaniel Priestley. For Sarah Law, with love. We walked the path in innocence because we do not know what is at its end. Robert McFarlane, Underland. Chapter 1. All murder investigations were different, and yet all of them began the same way, at least for me. Standing in silence near a body, trying to catch the faintest echo of what had happened. Sometimes the air still vibrated with violence and high emotion, and sometimes the silence was empty. It was a habit that I kept to myself, but one that reminded me of the fundamental truth. This was more than a job. Someone's life had been ended too soon. Finding out who had done it and why was my duty. Silence could be hard to come by, however, depending on the crime scene and who else was there. Currently, I was battling to hear anything over the hum of conversation from uniformed officers and scene of crime specialists, and, inevitably, my colleague, Detective Constable Georgia Shaw, who talked as if she was paid by the word. I tuned back in just in time to hear, "So, he was in the driver's seat, but I mean, clearly he didn't drive here, did he? Because he was already dead from what Dr. Early said, with the rigour and everything." The body was slumped, half of it inside a bright blue BMW sports car, half lolling through the open door. One arm dangled. Dr. Early, bright-eyed and brisk, had demonstrated with a quick swing that it hung loose. He would have been in full rigour when they moved him to the driver's seat. "You can see he's not in the correct position to have been driving. The angle of his legs is all wrong, and his feet wouldn't have been near the pedals. I'd guess he was curled up, and they were able to slide him into the seat all right, but they needed to move his arm to close the door." She had straightened up with a shrug. "You can break rigour, but you can't make it come back again." "So we were supposed to think he was killed in the car," I said, "and assume it happened here." "Your guess is as good as mine." Dr. Early had returned to her examination, probing the bloody mess on the top of the victim's head, where someone had hit him with enough force to smash his skull. The victim, Hassan Dawood, a doctor, aged 34. And where we stood was the car park of the big, sprawling London hospital where he had worked. It was just after 5 on a clear June morning, the light delicate but with the promise of heat later on. The nearest hospital building was a triumph of 60s brutalism, in stained concrete with aluminium-framed windows that flared brightly as the early sun caught them. Behind them, hundreds of onlookers, I guessed, attracted by the fuss of a murder investigation in full swing. We had taped off half of the car park, which sent the hospital authorities into a tizzy. People would be coming to appointments, and to visit their loved ones, and to visit A&E, and the car park was already inadequate. Without access to parking, the hospital simply could not function. The sooner we took our dead body and went, the better, they had strongly implied. "Do you want to talk to Liz St. John? She's keen to get home," Georgia said. "Who's that?" "Oh, the woman who found the body." My first instinct was to tell Georgia to do it. I spent a lot of time trying to give her jobs that she couldn't get wrong. In truth, my reluctance had more to do with the motivation I'd been struggling to find lately. I had seen the woman already, sitting in the back of a police car with the door open, a blanket around her shoulders, her eyes wide with the kind of stare that saw nothing. "Make an effort," I told myself. "I'll speak to her. They're ready to move the body, if you don't mind looking after that." "Of course." Georgia sounded keen and competent, and at least one of those things was true. She was getting a lot better I reminded myself. I still found myself checking up on her, but 9 times out of 10 she'd got everything right. It was really just the thought of the 10th time that kept me on edge. And speaking of being on edge, Liz St. John was doing a fair impression of someone who'd reached that state some time ago. She was holding a cup of tea, probably not the first one she'd been given. Her other hand was heavily bandaged. Mrs. St. John, I'm D.S. Maeve Kerrigan. I understand you found the body. She nodded. I didn't know. I said to the police when they came, I had no idea. I would never have opened the door if I'd known. You opened the car door? A convulsive nod. She was thin and pretty, usually, I guessed, though tiredness had put bags under her eyes and dulled her skin. Fair hair, fat diamond stud earrings, another few carrots on her fingers, and a mulberry bag at her feet. A well-off woman who had blundered into her worst nightmare. She was staring at me with matching interest, seeing, I supposed, someone whose life was nothing like her own. I was wearing a dark trouser suit with a plain white top underneath. Minimal jewellery, minimal makeup. I was tall and striking enough to attract attention, but I tried to look neutral when I was at work. What was routine to me was shocking to her, and I reminded myself to be gentle with her. Go back to the start. Why were you at the hospital? I was chopping carrots for the children's tea. Battens. She half laughed. They don't even like carrots, you know. They wouldn't have eaten them. And you cut your hand? I prompted. I wanted to get her out of there before the body was moved. It was behind screens, but there were things you didn't need to hear, never mind see. We have these knives. They're Japanese. Very expensive. They're far too sharp. I must have been distracted and I sliced into my hand. She grimaced. I had to wait for Huey, my husband, to come home before I could go to the hospital. To mind the children. So I was quite late getting here, and then it was a 4-hour wait. They made me have an X-ray. Anyway, they were nice to me. I was worried that I was wasting everyone's time by coming here, but... She trailed off, lifting her hand, showing me the bandages. What time did you leave the emergency department? Coming up on 2 in the morning. It was still busy. It's always busy, I said, with feeling. Yes. Anyway, I came out here and the parking machine was broken. She gestured in that general direction. There was a notice on it. Coins only. No notes. I mean, who carries that much change? And the amount they charge for parking. Well, I didn't have it. I was short £2. Everything was closed and there was no one around. I was stuck and Huey was at home with the kids, so I couldn't get him to come and rescue me. I knew the receptionists wouldn't be able to give me change, but I thought I might find someone to help. I was about to go back into the building when I saw the car. Hassan Dawood's car. She nodded. Why did you go over to it? Was there something about it that attracted your attention? She looked surprised. I knew him. He's my next-door neighbour. I blinked. Wow. Quite a coincidence, she frowned, except not really. Lots of doctors live around where we are, and it's the closest A&E to us. It wasn't a surprise to see someone I knew. I didn't think anything of it, except, oh good, Hassan will help me. The windows are tinted, but I could see him in the driver's seat. So you went over and knocked on the window. When he didn't look up, I opened the door, and he fell out. She swallowed convulsively. I thought he was ill. I thought, well, I don't know. But then his cap came off and I saw his head. It must have been a shock. A total shock. I was almost sick. She shut her eyes and I saw a glint of sweat across her forehead as if the nausea had returned. Hassan means handsome, did you know that? Someone at the playgroup told me. He was terrifically handsome. Beautiful, really. Seeing him like that was a nightmare. Did you touch him? I sort of caught him when he flopped out. I checked for a pulse, but he was cold. She shuddered. Maybe I shouldn't have touched him, but I didn't know. It was a pain, forensically speaking. I hoped she didn't know what I was thinking. We'll need to get a sample of your DNA, if that's all right. Of course. Anything. Was Hassan married? I had noticed a platinum ring on his hand. Yes, last year. They seemed happy. She bit her lip. Most of the time, anyway. What do you mean? There were arguments now and then. Breaking china. Shouting. Her eyes slid up to mine. It's not that I'm nosy. I couldn't help hearing when we had the back doors open. It gets so hot in the kitchen. Late at night, when they'd been partying, there were rows. Violent ones? I don't know. I can't say. Instant regret. Common to witnesses who felt they had said too much. She looked down at the tea. This is cold and disgusting. Could you take it away? I took the cup out of her hand and put it on the roof of the car. Go back to Mr. Dawood's marriage. Tell me about his wife. Sorry, I've misled you. Hassan didn't have a wife. He had a husband. Cameron. But he's away. She shivered. So it couldn't have been him who did this, could it? Chapter 2. I told you all of this before. We had a good marriage. Cameron Grant Dawood sat with his hands clasped in front of him on the table, pressed tightly together. A tremor ran through his body every few moments. A physical manifestation of the grief that had left him red-eyed and puffy-faced. He was big, his muscles well-defined, his shoulders straining the cotton of his T-shirt. He was 36, I knew, but his sandy hair was thinning across the back of his head already. The sun had burned him pink across the bridge of his nose and the upper part of his arms. He had come straight to meet us when he got back to London, pausing only to get his solicitor to join him. I was reserving my opinion of Cameron Dawood. Did you ever argue? Beside me, Georgia was taking a confident lead with questioning him. Of course. Of course, she repeated, her eyebrows raised as if she was surprised. Don't overplay it, Georgia. He shrugged. I'm not going to try to tell you we didn't fight now and then. That would be unrealistic. It would have been a lie, too, I thought. Was it physical? Georgia said, when you argued? No. Was there damage to property? No. Neither of you ever got angry enough to throw things? I said no. His jaw was clenched. That's not what we've heard, Georgia said cheerfully. And I saw his eyelids flicker as he thought about who might have come up with a different version of events. You must be talking about Liz. What makes you say that? Georgia hopped on what he'd said as if it was evidence of wrongdoing, and he sighed. I know she found him. You told me that much. So I suppose you've been talking to her. He rubbed his eyes. You can't have had time to talk to anyone else, really. What is it? 12 hours since he was found. Less than that. And I presume you want to start with me, since I'm his husband. He was no idiot, I thought, and he was easily outthinking my junior colleague. What difference does it make if Liz told us? My voice was quiet. It was almost the first thing I'd said in the whole interview. And Georgia looked around as if she had forgotten I was there. She was enjoying herself, and I was not. I wished I was somewhere else.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.